We are here to worship God. It's been a week again, but God is still on the throne. We want to praise Him. We want to glorify Him. We want to cast all our cares on Him, and we want to listen to Him this morning. Let's begin by going to Him in prayer together, shall we? Dear Father in heaven, may our worship this morning be in spirit and in truth. May we honor your name as holy. May we point others to you with the way we live and the way we worship. Lord, I pray that we'd be able to put all of the concerns of the world in the context of your love for us. And we'd understand that we are soldiers of the cross, and we'd fight the good fight with your strength and your protection. And when needed, God, you'd just carry us through. Now lead us to worship you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, good morning, one and all.
Good morning.
It's like you guys know I'm going to have to say good morning each week, but you guys are always seeming like you're surprised. Don't. Let's try that again. So, good morning, one and all.
Good morning.
There we go. That's much better. Well, let's just get right down to it.
Children of God, we are marching to Zion. Children of God, we are marching to Zion. Children of God, we are marching to Zion. Step by step, all the
Sanctity of Human Life, and this particular responsive reading speaks to that. So actually, if we'd have you stand today, we'll give you some calisthenic time. So if you would follow along with the blue text, please. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?
Learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, defend the fatherless, and plead for the widow.
Let justice roll down like waters, and let righteousness like an overflowing stream.
Be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves.
If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you will do well.
But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors.
What does it profit, my brethren, if a man says he has faith but has not works?
Can his faith save him?
If a brother or sister is ill-clad and in lack of daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for their body, what does it profit?
Religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world.
Amen. You may be seated. Lord, speak to us and let it apply to our lives. I pray in your name. Amen.
Boys and girls, good morning. I'm glad to be able to talk to you first before you fall asleep or get too involved in your art projects. That's too. I want to ask you something. Boys and girls, has anyone ever broken a promise that they made to you, or have they ever not done what they said they would do? Yes. How does that make you feel? Sad. It can sometimes make us angry or mad. And sometimes, you know what? It might, well, we don't feel anything because we're used to them not doing what they say. We're used to them breaking their promises. And we don't expect them to keep the truth in. Boy, parents, don't look around right now. There's some children that are nodding their heads. Yep, we're very used to that. Don't look. Might be yours. You know what? God always keeps his promises, boys and girls. Don't think God is like people. God is holy, and he'll never, ever break his promises to you. He'll always do what he says. But I have another thing. Well, before that, let me tell you what it says in Matthew 5:36. Jesus said in Matthew 5:36, basically he says, when you say you're going to do something, do it. If you say you're not going to do something, don't do it. He said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. And he said, anything else is from the devil. That means lying, not keeping your word, is from the devil. And the real question is this. Can people count on you to keep your word? If you tell people, including your parents, that you're going to do something, can they count on you to do it? Or are you like the people that disappoint you and don't keep their word? Are you like them? God wants you to be like him. Always keep your word, okay? But that takes a lot of work. So let me pray for you right now. Okay, boys and girls? Let's pray. God, I pray for these boys and girls. I pray, God, that they would grow up better than so many of us adults. I pray they would be children who become adults who keep their word, and they would do it now. That they wouldn't make rash promises, they'd only make ones that are well thought out and that you lead them to do. And that they'd be trustworthy and we can count on them. And then I pray, God, you'd protect them when others break their word to them. I pray it in Jesus' name, amen. This week, it's been like every other week, past, 11 months or so, I guess. But it was a tough week for us. The main part of our vacation in April, on Wednesday morning early, I got an email that the main part of our vacation, with it all wrapped around, was canceled. The company and all the companies who handle this kind of a vacation have canceled through April into May, some of them for the rest of the year even. And we'd paid for it. We had airplane tickets, everything. So while I was working on the sermon and taking a break from that, because you need to take a break at times, then I'd do this. I spent the day with my phone on hold and communicating on my laptop and then answering questions on other things, as well as two Zoom conferences. It was just crazy. I was making new reservations, going to Plan B, where we're still going to have vacation in April. It's just going to be different. And then the vacation we were going to have, we've rescheduled for October, hoping that things are a little more normal by then. But as I was doing all this and thinking, how frustrating is this, a reality dawned on me that this is an example of something, a first world problem. For those of you, most of you know what a first world problem is, but for those of you that don't know, Merriam-Webster's dictionary defines it this way. It's a usually minor or trivial problem or annoyance. Didn't seem so minor or trivial Wednesday. A minor or trivial problem or annoyance experienced by people in relatively affluent or privileged circumstances, especially as contrasted with problems of greater social significance facing people in poor and underdeveloped parts of the world. Examples of it given by, it's either a book or something else that's called the lip balm water bottle we never knew we needed. And gave examples of first world problems as bringing a stuffy nose home from vacation, chipping a fresh manicure, the waitress or waiter forgetting your extra ranch dressing again. These are problems we face that in most of the world, people would give anything to have those problems. People would give anything to have a vacation canceled or having to rearrange a vacation because it would mean they have a vacation. And it's inconceivable to them that people would spend money having their nails painted and having someone else take care of them. Or that they could go to a restaurant and have fresh food brought to them and be concerned because they didn't get that free little extra thing with it. That's just mind-blowing to people in third world countries. Do you realize how many of your problems are completely insignificant when compared to what others are facing in the world? Do we think about that? And yes, many of them are in third world countries, but some are right under our noses. And we've either failed to see them or we've chosen to ignore them. Today, the title is Doing What Is Right and Just. And the key verse is Deuteronomy 18, verse 19. Let me preface it with this. Genesis, what did I say?
Deuteronomy.
Computer error. Genesis 18, 19. Thank you. It is Genesis 18, 19. God is immutable. God does not change. The way of the Lord is the same now as always. But what is that? What is the way of the Lord? In Genesis 18, we were in Genesis 19 last week, and I gave a brief overview of Genesis 18. And in Genesis 18, Abraham, remember, he was standing there in the door to his tent, and he saw three men coming. It turned out to be the Lord. The word is Elohim. It's a reference to Jehovah God, the one true God. And two angels, we find out. And they went on to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah and all that. But Abraham greeted them, he fed them, he provisioned them, he cleaned them, everything was taken care of. And as they were leaving, he did what a good host would do. He saw them off. He walked with them. And that's when God, speaking to himself basically out loud, obviously so that Abraham could hear it. Beginning in verse 17, our key verse is verse 19, but verse 17 of Genesis 18, the Lord said, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him?" Now, first of all, how were all the nations of the earth blessed in Abraham? Descendants of Abraham went down, including King David, and then down way past that to Jesus Christ. And all the world's blessed through Jesus Christ. Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Anyone can accept this blessing, this gift. Then verse 19, God says, "For I have chosen him that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, so that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he's promised him." So it's not just how we please God by doing righteousness and justice, doing what is right and what is just, it is how we imitate him. God does right. God does what is just. So it says the way of the Lord teaches children and this household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, doing what is right and just. And that's determined by God. The world wants it another way, but righteousness and justice are determined by God, and they don't change to suit our ever-changing opinions, our personal outlooks, our convenience, and or our circumstances. God's truth doesn't change. He's immutable, and his truth and righteousness and justice are not subject to man's laws, which, as we're going to observe, change a lot to fit sinful desires. And it relates directly to the sanctity of human life, but that's all life. Some scriptures relate to the sanctity of human life. Some scriptures we've done in the responsive reading, I was going, hey, I recognize these. That was great. John 10:10, a thief comes only to kill, rob, kill, and destroy. I came so that everyone would have life and have it in its fullness. John 14, verse 6, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Genesis 2, verse 7, the Lord has told you what is good. He has told you what he wants from you. Do what is right to other people. Love being kind to them and live humbly, trusting your God. Matthew 25, verse 40, the king will reply. Matthew 25, 40, you remember this is when Jesus said when the Son of Man comes again, he's going to separate people into two groups. Some are going to have eternal life and some are going to be cast into the lake of fire for eternal punishment. And he said verse 40 there, the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. In Micah chapter 6, verse 8, mankind, he has told each of you what is good and what it is the Lord requires of you, to act justly, to love faithfulness, and to walk humbly with your God. And then Isaiah 61, 1. The Spirit of the Lord has taken control of me. The Lord has chosen and sent me to tell the oppressed the good news, to heal the brokenhearted, and to announce freedom for prisoners and captives. These are just some of the verses related to it. The Bible's full of them. But the truth is, we've been guilty of focusing on just one aspect of the sanctity of human life. And Southern Baptists in particular have been very guilty of making at least 90% of our focus on one issue. And one of the reasons I believe for that is on another issue that we'll get to at the very end. It's related to something we haven't been just guilty of in the past, but we were founded on our guilt in it when it comes to slavery. But the first one is the one we focused on a lot, and it needs focus. Abortion. Because we're going to talk five areas. Abortion, we're going to talk about orphans and widows, and foreigners. We're going to put foreigners with orphans and widows, although they're two different things, because most of the verses that talk about foreigners also talk about orphans and widows. We're going to talk about vows and promises in the context of our nation, treaties, and then human trafficking, but abortion. And we're going to be very brief on this because hopefully by this time you know where I stand and where God's word stands on abortion.
Don't kill babies.
We know. Good. God is a God of life. There is nothing in all of Scripture to even remotely justify killing babies born or unborn. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 and 20. Today I ask heaven and earth to be witnesses. I am offering you life or death. Those are the choices. Blessings or curses. Now choose life. Then you and your children may live. Love the Lord your God. Obey him. Stay close to him. He is your life, and he will let you live many years in the land. This is the land he promised to give your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Life. We don't take it. Not from the innocent, not for convenience or for better chance of success in life. I read again someone commenting that people who are pro-lifers and against abortion are ignorant and backwards, and they're uninformed and everything, because if you don't let a person choose to have an abortion, then you're robbing that woman of her future goals and her welfare and being able to make more money and the education. And they never say it's worth killing a baby over. But that's what they're saying. It's not. It's against God. The second thing, care for orphans and widows, and we'll also add foreigners. The word foreigners literally means alien. In the scriptures, when it talks about foreigners, it does it a lot, especially in the Old Testament. It's talking about someone who's not a part of your tribe, your race, your ethnicity, but they're living among you. It's also talking about people who are just passing through your land, your area, or people who are from outside who've come and are living among you. But they're keeping their own culture and all that stuff too. That's what it means. In James chapter 1, verse 27, religion that God the Father accepts is this, caring for orphans or widows who need help and keeping yourself free from the world's evil influence. This is the kind of religion that God accepts as pure and good. I hope by now you understand the argument being presented today on the sanctity of human life is not Pastor Jim's opinion. You've already gotten a lot of scripture, and you're going to get a lot more, because we want to know, what does God say? He's immutable. His truth doesn't change. So if you have an argument with it, I'm happy to have you go to the person with whom you have the argument. It's God. Okay? I'm siding with God. I've sided not with God before, and it never worked out well. The next scripture, Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 18. Referring to God. He helps orphans and widows. He loves foreigners. He gives them food and clothes. Deuteronomy 26:12. When you finish setting aside a tenth of all the produce in the third year, the year of the tithe, you shall give it to the Levite, the foreigner, the fatherless, the widow, so that they may eat in your towns and be satisfied. I need to pause here. This is a tough one to understand. If you go to the original language, it was for me. I read it in the Hebrew here, and I went, huh? But then with people who studied it really good, because there are those who think that there's two and a third tithes commanded in the Old Testament. There's two clear ones, and that this is a third one that you give every third year. But others who are scholars in the study it say, what it means is on this particular tithe every third year, this is the way the money's to be allocated. And there's nothing that says that's not true. You can do it either way. You can say there's two tithes or two and a third tithes. But the money from this tithe goes to helping orphans and widows, the Levites, who were the people who, they were the tribe of Israel that became not one of the inheritors. They didn't inherit everything that the sons of Levi did. Joseph's two sons each got one portion, so they still had 12 tribes. The Levites were scattered among all the tribes, and they took care of the spiritual welfare of the nation. When they went into the promised land, all the tribes got different land apportioned to them, except the Levites, and they were given to the different places and given a place to live, but they were to take care of the spiritual needs, to teach the people what God says, to help them understand and do those things. Now, they might have a little crop and things they could raise, but their business was tending to the spiritual needs of the people. And there's not a lot of money in that. And so God says, here, you give this to them. You provide for them. The Levites, the foreigners, the fatherless and the widow, so that they may eat and be satisfied. In Deuteronomy 27:19, anyone will be cursed who is unfair to foreigners, orphans, or widows. Then all the people will say, amen. You know what that means? It means, so be it. That's right. They will agree to it. In Psalm 146, verse 9, the Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the way of the wicked. Isaiah 1:17, learn to do what is good, pursue justice, correct the oppressor, defend the righteous, the rights of the fatherless, plead the widow's cause. Jeremiah 7, verse 6, stop taking advantage of foreigners, orphans, and widows. Don't kill innocent people. Goes back to the abortion thing, doesn't it? They're not the only innocent, but they're definitely innocent. And stop worshiping other gods. Zechariah chapter 7, verse 10. Don't hurt widows and orphans, foreigners, or the poor. Don't even think of doing evil to somebody else. So is it kind of clear where God stands on this? Rather clear. The next thing, don't break a vow or a promise. This is where I cut the sermon down from over 45 minutes to where you probably will be able to stay awake all morning now. Because I'm going to just basically brush by a couple things. In our nation, we have a history of making promises and breaking promises. The Supreme Court in 1831 declared all Native Americans to be domestic dependent nations, meaning they're wards of the government. The government gave itself the authority to determine what's best for all the Native Americans, the tribes and stuff. Because they basically said they aren't capable of governing themselves and being competent to address major issues and even be real legal landowners like I am right now. In truth, according to the ruling, tribes don't technically own their own land, the reservations. They have to get permission to do anything on it, technically. Now, the government lets them do things, but the government owns the lands. In 1823, in a case, SCOTUS decided that basically the Europeans, when they came to North America, they owned it all, on what they called the doctrine of discovery. Sorry, Monsoon. We own it all. And the reason we own it all is we decided we did. Person with the most toys wins, you know. And that's really what they did. And if you ever want some of the links that I've used and stuff, email me and say, can I have a couple of those links? And basically you can just look up on any web browser, United States government broken treaties or anything like that. But back in 1868, which none of you were alive then, or at least you were very young. Hi, Mary. Back in, she's going to kill me, isn't she? Okay. It was nice knowing everybody. In 1868, there was a treaty that was signed in various locations in the Wyoming Territory, including Fort Laramie, but other military posts as well. And the government recognized at that time that the Black Hills of South Dakota belonged to the Sioux and the Arapahoes. The Sioux were comprised basically of the Dakota, Lakota, and Nakota. And they said, it's theirs. It belongs to them. And then some people who were not Native American came in illegally and without permission. And guess what they found there?
Gold.
There's gold in them thar hills. They found gold. News spread. They came in. Well, the people that owned the land by the government's decree said, you have to leave. Go out. And there became conflict. Well, the whites, they said, protect us. And they cried out to the government and the military. And it ended up in the Battle of Little Bighorn, really. And on it went, right? And then there was more decrees that this and that and all that stuff. People going back on the nation going back on its word. But in 1980, the Supreme Court ruled that the Black Hills were illegally confiscated. It took till 1980, and they said that was illegal. And so they awarded the Sioux more than $100 million. Now, I'll tell you what, if someone came in here today and they said, we'll give you folks $100 million for the buildings and the land on which you meet, I would be the first person saying, sell, people, sell. Because those of us in here, we get a lot of money. Everyone here, matter of fact, anyone who's an active member but hadn't come, because that'd be a lot of money for us and we'd buy better and elsewhere. That'd be a problem. But we're talking about massive amount of land that was very special to these Native Americans. And when they awarded that over $100 million to them, you know what the leaders said of the Native Americans? They said, no, it's not for sale. The white man is here illegally. It's our land. They're trespassing. We've always said that. We've never said anything else. We don't want the $100 million, which has sat in an account gathering interest ever since then, since 1980, so for 41 years. That's the way we've treated people. And we need to say, this is wrong. It gets into a real controversy because we're to obey government authorities. As long as we don't disobey God, but we're to defend the rights of people who are wronged. So what do we do? Well, there's a lot of things, and it really needs to be discussed and prayed about and talked about. There's no easy answer. There really isn't, short of the government just saying, everybody out, it's theirs. I don't see the government doing that right now. But and I hate paying taxes. Anybody here enjoy paying taxes? You like paying those taxes? Oh, no, you don't. Okay. I don't like paying them, but I pay them. And if they could show a foolproof way, which the government's failed at forever and a day, local governments and everything, of saying, we're going to take this money and we're going to use it to slowly buy back all that land from those who are there, companies, cities, individuals, and make sure that that goes back to them. And this is one example, by the way. I'd support a tax. You know, they want to do a nationwide tax of 1% added on. Okay. I don't like paying taxes, but to do what is right, I'd do it. But this is not going to go easy. The trouble is the government, they said, if you allow the lottery, it's going to take care of education.
Oh, they lie on that one.
Boy, that worked, didn't it? If you allow this and that's going to take care of all of our highways and everything. That's the problem, is that trust factor we talked about with the children, isn't it? But folks, we need to stand up for the rights of people who've been wronged. And not hide away from it. Things that are right under our very noses. Listen to what the scripture says. Matthew 30, verse 2. If a man vows a vow to the Lord or swears an oath to bind himself by pledge, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceeds out of his mouth. Some people said, yes, that's if you make a promise to God. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, God says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, will forgive their sins and heal their land. But he's saying, if people who call themselves my followers, if we're a Christian, we're calling ourselves his followers and our lives are as his ambassador. Paul wrote, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though Christ is making his appeal through us, be reconciled to God. So everything we do as children of God, we do in his name. And when we make a promise as Christians, we're promising God the same thing. Deuteronomy 23, verse 21. If you make a vow to the Lord your God, do not be slow to keep it, because he will require it of you, and it will be counted against you as sin. Leviticus 5, 4 and 5. You are guilty the moment you realize that you've made a hasty promise to do something good or bad. As soon as you discover that you've committed any of these sins, you must confess what you've done. Psalm 51, the first five verses. Lord, who can dwell in your tent? Who can live in your holy mountain? In other words, who can approach you? The one who lives blamelessly, practices righteousness, and acknowledges the truth in his heart, who does not slander with his tongue, who does not harm his friend or discredit his neighbor, who despises the one rejected by the Lord, but honors those who fear him, who keeps his word whatever the cost. I like to toss that one out of the Bible. It'd be convenient. Who does not lend his silver at interest or take a bribe against the innocent. The one who does these things will never be shaken. Psalm 89, verse 34. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Matthew 5, 37. When you make a promise, say only yes or no. Anything else comes from the devil. And then Hebrews 13, 5. Keep your life free from love of money. That's what led to all these treaty violations. And be content with what you have, for he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The last thing we're going to talk about is human trafficking. In 2017, the most recent year for which data is available, law enforcement agencies reported over 1,200 legal cases of human trafficking in the United States, and that's according to the crime statistics from the Federal Bureau of Investigation that are publicly available, not ones that are even ongoing cases. Some experts, and there are people who this is their life's mission, is this is what they deal with, is human trafficking. These experts believe that that represents less than 10% of the actual cases, and some believe it's less than 1%. At a conference on this horrible crime of human trafficking, Louise Shelley, who's the founder and director of this group called, or a nonprofit called Terrorism Transnational Crime, that means crime that doesn't care where the boundaries are, and Corruption Center in Washington, D.C., states that the vast majority of sex trafficking victims in the United States are predominantly young Americans, ranging in number from 100,000 to 300,000, with an additional 14,500 to 17,500 from Asia, Latin America, and former Soviet bloc countries. The traffickers themselves, who are doing the business, range from organized crime syndicates, smaller family operations, common pimps, and motorcycle gangs. These numbers were reported in 2018 based on previous year statistics, and everyone agrees the numbers have been growing ever since. I'm a member of the Bremerton Central Lions Club that does a lot of projects for the community and things like that. And we have different guest speakers every week. And we've had the sheriff of Kitsap County, the deputy sheriff of Kitsap County, the police chief for Bremerton. And when approached about this and asked questions, they've been very frank and honest about it. The police chief for the city of Bremerton said a few years ago, Bremerton is one of the worst states in the nation when it comes to sex trafficking. He says, we don't even see it, and it's right in front of our eyes. He says, it is so bad here that on a national level, they know Bremerton is one of the worst, which spreads to the whole county then. Because how many naval installations do we have here? A bunch. And wherever you have military installations, you have young single men and things like that, or who are away from their spouses, and they're looking to go have a wild time or fill their sexual gratification. Anytime there's a convention in any city or town, the major business taking place that you don't see, you don't read about, is sex trafficking in any city. They flood, they bring them in and all that stuff. These people are prisoners to it. Before we came here, we were at Trinity Baptist Church in Lakewood. Two cases. One time, we had a young couple that was coming, military couple, and she wanted a visit from me, and so I said, I never visit a woman alone, I just don't do it. And so the pastor and I went and visited, and we spoke with her, and inside of about a half an hour, we learned that her husband was trafficking her out to other servicemen. And we said, we're going to help you, it's never going to happen again, and he's never going to touch you again. She called a neighbor who was just a few doors down in this apartment complex, right outside the gates to Fort Lewis, or McCord, excuse me, and she came down, and her husband was doing the same thing. We found out it was very common in that area. So we had a colonel and some high-ranking officers, and we contacted them. We got a hold of the general or whoever was in charge in their office, and those soldiers all ended their military career and began their career in the brig. And all the wives got protection. Some of them got identity, new identities, and they were, and we wouldn't let go of it. We said, we're not going to let go of this yet until we got assurances and promises, and the women confirmed it, that the government was taking care of these women who had been trafficked by their own husbands and provided for and given educations and getting on their feet and that kind of thing. That was, we had a girl, and her mom moved right across this little two-lane street from the church in a duplex. And they seemed to be fine, all that. She'd come outside to feed the dog and play with the dog, and then she'd go back inside. About 2 years after that, we'd gone over there and visited them and that kind of stuff, but never allowed in. They didn't want to talk. She came over. She is 12. And she was very friendly, sweet girl. And she began to talk to us. And then one time she says, can I talk to you privately? And so the pastor and I, we talked to her privately with the secretary present. We said, we have to have a woman here present. And so with the secretary present, she poured out what had been happening since she was 8 years old. Her mother had been selling her for men to have sex with her, starting when she was eight, so that the mother could get free drugs. And now she's 12. She contracted cervical cancer from all this illicit stuff. The mother denied it. The end result was when she was 14, cutting out a lot going on here. The mother was arrested, taken away. The daughter was taken away from the mother, placed in foster care that we had a lot of voice in with a family in Gig Harbor. So it was from Lakewood to Gig Harbor, not far, with a family that attended Chapel Hill Presbyterian Church, and were very faithful there. Well, we knew about Chapel Hill, good, solid congregation. And this family, strong couple, that had the monetary resources, they said, we don't even need the state's help, but the state was going to do it anyway. You got to do their terms. And they had a son and a daughter. And they, one of the things was that we said, we don't ever want her alone with any single person in the family, wherever she goes. And they agreed totally. We think that's right. So she is never alone with her foster sister, with her foster brother, with her foster mother, her foster dad. Always a group. When the son graduated, and she was pregnant from one of the pimps when she was one of the people that would pay for it, and she'd get her drugs, the mother would get drugs. She had the baby. They said they'd adopt the baby or they'd help her keep her own baby. And they would adopt her even. But they did not adopt her because when their son graduated from high school, he said, God, he met with mom and dad first. He had never been alone with the girl, but he says, this is what God wants in my life. I do need to go to college, but I need to marry her. That baby's going to have a daddy, and she's going to have a husband that'll never, ever mistreat her. And they all lived happily ever after type of thing. It really, God worked it out really good. But folks, that was happening no further apart than the wall, closer than the wall of the far wall of the fellowship hall there. That's how close they lived. It's all around us. Now, I'm in the same position as most people. You know, I don't see all of it. Here's what the scripture says. Psalm 82, verses 3 and 4. Provide justice for the needy and fatherless. Uphold the rights of the oppressed and the destitute. Rescue the poor and needy. Save them from the power of the wicked. And it is a power. It's mind control. It's everything. Proverbs 31, 8 and 9. Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. Defend the rights of all those who have nothing. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and needy. 1 Thessalonians 4, 3 through 7. God wants you to be holy. So don't be immoral in matters of sex. Respect and honor your wife. Don't be a slave of your desires or live like people who don't know God. You must not cheat any of the Lord's followers in matters of sex. Remember, we warned you that he punishes everyone who does such things. God did not choose you to be filthy, but to be pure. Deuteronomy 24:7. If someone is caught kidnapping a fellow Israelite and treating or selling them as a slave, the kidnapper must die. You must purge the evil from among you. There's been a lot of talk about how the Bible justifies slavery. The Bible never justifies slavery. And slavery in the Bible wasn't like our slavery early years of the United States, which is chattel slavery. It's a property can be disposed of, killed, regarded, not even human life. In the Bible, so many of the slaves sold themselves into slavery to pay a debt, and it was for a given amount of time. If it was an Israelite, at the end of 6 years, that seventh year, is set free, debt paid. a different thing. And he could choose to stay with the master if the master allowed it, because that he became part of the family and have a hole drilled in the ear and, hey, adopted, as it were, or a slave, a servant for life. The word was used, bond servant, paying off a debt. And the slavery we have here, it was much worse. And this kind of slavery we're talking about this morning is even worse, because we're pretending it's not even there. But that was Israelite to Israelite. Exodus 21 verse 16 is not talking about just Israelites. It's talking about how we behave as God's children towards anybody. And he that stealeth a man and selleth him, or if he be found in his hand, in other words, he's a part of it, even though he wasn't the original enslaver, he's using him, he shall surely be put to death. How does God view slavery? What penalty does God say? It's a death penalty. He takes it very seriously. We need to take it seriously too. We can't just turn a blind eye to it and pretend it's not there. Folks, somehow we got to pay the price and get this done. And as I said, I'm in the same position as most, if not all of you. Some of this just doesn't exist in the world in which I live most of the time, of which I'm aware. Now, yes, as a pastor, you tend to be more aware of it because it's brought to your attention, and then you get sensitized to it. And those two cases I mentioned at the other church, those aren't the only things that have gone on. But I need to ask God to make me more and more aware and sensitive to the needs, including those to which I've been blind or chose to ignore. I need to recognize them when they're right in front of me. I need to search for ways to fight for people's lives. And so do you. I've done some of it, but considering the size of the problem, it's so little, and I need to do more. Not just with this thing of human trafficking, but on keeping promises, the poor and the widows and the orphans and the foreigners, abortion, all that. I can never do enough because the problem's still there. God's not going to look and say, ah, I saw that year. You did a couple things that year. That's good. Jesus said, what you've done to the least of these, you've done to me. And he included all of them. As a congregation, can we become a shelter, a refuge place for people who are in these situations? Can we focus on how to help them so that they know there is help there? There are laws and stuff that don't let us have people living in this building. We tried that over at Trinity. You can get in trouble doing that. For instance, though, after a woman or a teen has an abortion, say in our congregation, and we find out about it, are we willing to love them, to help them, and show them God's love after the fact? Think about what Jesus did. Jesus sought out these people. They didn't just happen. He didn't stumble upon them. He said, Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to your house. And he was wretched. The woman caught in adultery. All these people, sinful people, Jesus sought them out. Can we have that kind of a heart? I pray we can. I pray you will do what I do. God, make me more caring, more sensitive. I want to be more like Jesus. I don't want to reject those people. And it's a challenge, folks. I was a youth pastor for 31 years and 8 months to the day. And I had young people who got pregnant. Boys got girls pregnant, or girls got pregnant. And I know what can go on in the hearts and minds of people. And know this also, when a young lady or just a woman gets pregnant out of wedlock, not married, there are always some people that judgmentally look at them. It's not the majority usually in a congregation like this, but even if one does it, the person who gets pregnant out of wedlock has the tendency to believe everyone is judging her. It's not something she wants to believe, but she believes it. Everyone is judging me. I can feel it when I walk in. And they do feel this. It's a satanic attack, and they don't recognize that. But our love for them has to be so great that they cannot reject it, deny it. They have to understand the love here is great. It's Satan that's trying to destroy me. And we have to be that kind of a congregation towards pregnancies, towards anyone, towards Native Americans, or any culture. Do we want to have that kind of a heart that Jesus had? Do we want to do what is right and just? How much do we want to do it? How much shall we sacrifice? This morning, you might be thinking, this is kind of new to me. I don't know where that love would come from. It comes from God. If you've never given your life to God, I want you to know something. When you give your life to God, He turns you into a whole new creature. Amen. It's a process, yes. I gave my life to God years ago, and I'm still growing in this. But He can turn you into something new. He can take the filth in your life and get rid of it. He can forgive all of it. He can take away the guilt from it. You might want to do what it says on my next steps there on the sermon notes, the bottom of that page or on the connection card. It says, today I'm surrendering my life and will to the care and control of Jesus Christ, and I want to be baptized. Turn your life over to Him. Accept the fact that you need Him, that you've done wrong, but He'll forgive you. Jesus died for your sins. He is God in the flesh. He lived a perfect life. He gave His life for you. And then He ascended into heaven. He rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, and He sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And someday He's coming back for us, and it can't be soon enough. But He can have your life, and He will not mess it up, and you can do it this morning. Just give your life to Him. If you check on your connection card that you're doing that for the first time today and you want to be baptized, then put a note down there and say, I'd like to talk about what I've done and being baptized. We're going to get to you. I don't care if we have to wear masks to do it and everything. We'll even baptize you. We don't have to wait till this is all over. And to keep the skin contact and everything down, I'll find a hazmat suit or something. We'll baptize you. The important thing is you being obedient to God. If you've already done that, I want to encourage you and challenge you for the second, my next step. This week I will read Isaiah 58, verses 6 and 7. Didn't read them this morning on purpose. And ask God to open my eyes to ways that I can be involved in treating all people right and just. And the key to it is you start off by saying, God, open my eyes to how I can be involved in treating all people right and just. Not playing favorites, but all people. And then read that verse and see what God has to say to you. If you're willing to do that, check that so I can be praying for you this week, okay? Let's pray together. Let's spend some time praying, because God may have something else He lays on your heart and mind that you need to do, but you might not know it unless you spend some time talking to Him. So let's spend some time right now in prayer. Before we dismiss, I want to encourage you to study the Word of God. We're not having Sunday school right now. That's aggravating. But you can study God's Word at home, and you need to study God's Word at home. You need to know more of what His Word means, and even looking into what words mean. You know, we mentioned orphans and widows as an example today. You know, in the New Testament, a widow wasn't just a woman whose husband had died. To be put on the widow's list, and you know the average life expectancy back then? It wasn't as long as it is now. It was pretty short. But to be on the widow's list, you had to be at least 60 and have no means of support from family or anybody. You had to be destitute. You had to be that woman that Jesus saw putting two mites into the temple offering. And Jesus said, she gave everything she had. That's it. To get on that list, study God's Word. There's a lot of things that will open your eyes to it. There's online resources that are free to help you with it. But spend time studying God's Word prayerfully, because then He'll talk to you and He'll open up deeper truths to you. All right.
Down the mountain, the river flows. It brings refreshing wherever it goes. Through the valleys and over the fields, the river is rushing and the river is here. The river of God sets our feet a-dancing. The river of God fills our hearts with cheer. The river of God fills our mouths with laughter, and we rejoice, for the river is here. The river of God is teeming with life, and all who touch it can be revived. And those who linger on this river shore will come back thirsting for more of the Lord. The river of God sets our feet a-dancing. The river of God fills our hearts with cheer. The river of God fills our mouths with laughter, and we rejoice, for the river is here. Up the mountain we love to go, to find the presence of the Lord. Along the banks of the river we run, we dance with laughter, giving praise to the sun. The river of God sets our feet a-dancing. The river of God fills our hearts with cheer. The river of God fills our mouths with laughter, and we rejoice, for the river is here. The river of God sets our feet a-dancing. The river of God fills our hearts with cheer. The river of God fills our mouths with laughter, and we rejoice, for the river is here. And we rejoice, for the river is here. And we rejoice, for the river is here.
Have a blessed week. You're dismissed.
Thank you.